Chapter 59. What happened at Portsmouth on the 23rd of August, 1628. Elton took leave of her ladyship, just as a brother who was going out for a mere walk takes leave of his sister, by kissing her hand. His whole manners and appearance indicated a state of ordinary tranquility, except that a strange gleam, like the brilliancy of fever, beamed from his eyes. His forehead was even more calm than usual. His teeth were firmly closed, and his speech had a short and abrupt tone, which seemed to denote that his thoughts were intent upon some gloomy purpose. As long as he remained in the boat which took him ashore, it kept his face turned towards her ladyship, who, standing on the deck, followed him with her eyes. Neither of them now entertained much fear of being pursued. Her ladyship's apartment was never entered before 9 o'clock in the morning, and it took some hours to travel from the castle to London. Elton set his foot on shore, climbed the rising ground which led to the top of the cliff, saluted her ladyship for the last time, and took his way towards the town. After 100 steps, as the path descended as it proceeded, he could no longer see more than the mast of the vessel. He hastened as fast as possible in the direction of Portsmouth, which, through the morning mist, he could discern in the distance. Beyond the town, the sea was covered with innumerable ships whose masts, like a forest of poplars stripped of their leaves by winter, were bending before the breath of the wind. During this rapid walk, Belton resolved in his mind all the accusations, whether true or false, with which 10 years of ascetic meditation and a long intercourse with the Puritans had furnished him against the royal favour. When he compared the public crimes of this minister, crimes which were notorious and, in a manner, European, with those private and unknown vices of which her ladyship had accused him, Belton found that the most culpable of the two beings whom Buckingham united in himself was the one whose life was hidden from the world. His own love, so singular and fresh and ardent, made him see the infamous and imaginary accusations of her ladyship as one sees through a microscope the form of frightful monsters, atoms of insects, otherwise imperceptible. The rapidity of his progress also inflamed his blood. The idea that he left behind him, exposed to a dreadful vengeance, the woman whom he loved, or rather adored as a saint, his past emotions and his present fatigue, all tended to excite and elevate his soul above the feelings of humanity. On entering Portsmouth, he found the whole population astir. The drums were beating in the streets and in the harbour, and the troops about to be embarked were descending towards the sea. Felton arrived at the Admiralty House, covered with dust and wet with perspiration. His usually pale face was purple with heat and anger. The sentinel wished to stop him, but Felton called for the officer on guard and drew from his pocket the letter which he carried. "An express from Lord de Winter," said he. At the name of Lord de Winter, who was known to be one of Buckingham's most intimate friends, the officer gave an order for the admission of Felton, who, moreover, wore the uniform of a naval officer himself. Felton rushed into the house, but the moment he reached the hall, another man also entered, covered with dust and out of breath, having left at the door a post horse, which, on reaching it, had fallen on its knees. Both individuals addressed Patrick, the Duke's confidential valet, at the same moment. Felton named the Baron de Winter. The stranger refused to mention any name and declared that he could make himself known to no one but the Duke. Both insisted on being allowed priority of admission. Patrick, who knew that Lord de Winter was connected, both by profession and friendship, with his grace, gave the preference to him who came. The other was obliged to wait, and it was easy enough to see how fast he was. The valet conducted Felton to a large room, in which were waiting the deputies of La Rochelle, headed by the Prince's servants, and introduced him into a cabinet, but Buckingham, having just left the mast, was finishing his toilet, which, now, as ever, he accorded extreme attention. "Lieutenant Felton," said Patrick, "from Lord de Winter."
"From Lord de Winter?"
repeated Buckingham.
"Show him in."
Felton entered. At this moment, Buckingham threw upon a sofa a rich dressing gown brocaded with gold, and put on a doublet of blue velvet entirely embroidered with flowers.
"Why did the Baron not come himself?"
demanded Buckingham.
"I expected him this morning."
"He desired me to inform your Grace," said my father, "that he very much regretted not having that honour, but that he was prevented by the watch which he is obliged to keep at the castle."
"Oh yes,"
said Buckingham. "I know about that. He has a lady prisoner there." "He is, in fact, about that prisoner. I should speak to your Grace," said my father.
"Well, proceed."
"What I have to say to you, my lord, must be heard by yourself alone."
"Play with Patrick,"
said Buckingham.
"We keep within earshot. I will call you presently."
Patrick left the room.
"We are alone, sir,"
said Buckingham.
"Speak."
"My lord," said my father, "the Baron de Winter lately wrote to your Grace requesting you to sign an order for the transportation of a young woman named Charlotte Baxter."
"Yes, sir. I might apply that he should either bring or send me the order, and I would sign it."
"Here it is, my lord."
"Give it to me,"
said the Duke. Taking the paper from Felton's hands, his Grace cast a rapid glance over its contents. Then, perceiving it was really that which had been referred to, he laid it on the table and declared to sign it. "Pardon me, my Grace," said Felton, interrupting the Duke, "but is your Grace aware that Charlotte Baxter is not the real name of this female?"
"Yes, sir, I know that,"
replied the Duke, dipping his pen into the ink. "Then your Grace is acquainted with her real name?" demanded Felton, in an abrupt tone.
"I do know."
The Duke put the pen to the paper. Felton became pale. "And knowing his real name," resumed Felton, "will your Grace still sign the paper?"
"Certainly,"
said Buckingham.
"And rather twice than once."
"I cannot believe," continued Felton, in a voice which became more and more abrupt and reproachful, "that your Grace is aware that this refers to Lady de Winter."
"I'm perfectly aware of it. No, I'm astonished that you should be."
"And your Grace will sign this order without remorse." Buckingham looked awfully at the speaker.
"Do you happen to know, sir," said he, "that you're asking me some strange questions? And though I'm very foolish, you answer them."
"Answer them, my lord," said Felton. "Your position is perhaps more serious than you suppose." Buckingham thought that as the young man came from Lord de Winter, he probably spoke in his name. He therefore restrained himself.
"Without any remorse, whatever,"
said he.
"And the Baron knows as well as I do that her ladyship is a great criminal to whom it is almost a favour to reduce her punishment to transportation."
The Duke again put his pen to the paper. "You shall not sign that order, my lord," said Felton, making a step towards the Duke.
"I shall not sign this order,"
exclaimed Buckingham.
"And why not?"
"The
because you will consult your own conscience, and will render justice to the lady.
It would be bad justice if she were sent to Tyburn,
said the Duke.
Her ladyship is an infamous creature.
My lord, her ladyship is an angel. You know it well, and I demand her liberty.
Ah, said Buckingham. Are you mad thus to speak to me?
Excuse me, my lord. I speak as I am able. I restrain myself.
Yet, my lord, think of what you are about to do. Beware lest the cup should overflow.
What does he mean?
God forgive me,
exclaimed Buckingham.
I verily believe he threatens me.
No, my lord. I implore you still, and I warn you. One drop of water is sufficient to make the full vase overflow. A slight fault is sufficient to draw down vengeance upon the head which has been spared to this day, in spite of so many crimes.
Mr. Felton,
said Buckingham,
you will leave this room and immediately place yourself under arrest.
And you, my lord, will hear me to the end. You have seduced this young girl. You have violated and polluted her. Prepare your crimes towards her. Let her depart freely, and I will exact nothing more of you.
You will exact nothing more?
Cried Buckingham, looking at Felton with astonishment, and dwelling on each syllable of the words which he had just pronounced. My lord, continued Felton, becoming more excited as he spoke. My lord, be careful. The whole of England is wearied by your iniquities. My lord, you have abused the royal power which you have almost usurped. My lord, you are an abomination to God and man. God will punish you in his fellowship, and I will punish you now.
Ah, this is rather too much,
exclaimed Buckingham, making a step towards the door. Felton opposed his progress. I humbly entreat you, said he, to sign an order for the liberation of Lady de Winter. Report that it is the woman whom you have dishonored.
Leave the room, sir,
said Buckingham,
or I will call my servants to eject you.
You will not call them, replied Felton, throwing himself between the Duke and the bell which was placed upon a stand inlaid with silver. Take care, my lord, for you are now in God's hands.
In the devil's hands, you mean?
Exclaimed Buckingham, elevating his voice so as to attract the attention of those without, without exactly calling. Sign, my lord, sign the liberation of Lady de Winter, said Felton, pushing a paper towards the Duke.
Under compulsion? You are making a fool of yourself. Hello there, Patrick.
Sign, my lord.
Never!
Help! Cried the Duke, at the same time leaping towards his sword. But Felton did not give him time to draw. The open knife with which her ladyship had wounded herself was concealed under his doublet, and in one bound he was upon the Duke. At that same moment, Patrick entered the room, exclaiming,
My lord, a letter from France!
From France!
Cried Buckingham, forgetting everything as he imagined from whom that letter came. Felton took advantage of the moment and buried the knife up to its handle in the Duke's side.
Ah, traitor!
Exclaimed Buckingham.
Thou hast slain me! Murder!
Shouted Patrick. Felton cast his eyes around and seeing the door free, he rushed into the adjoining room where, as we have said, the deputies of La Rochelle were waiting, passed through it still running, and hurried towards the staircase. But upon the first step, he met Lord de Winter, who, on seeing him wild, looking and livid, and with blood upon his hands and face, rushed upon him and exclaimed,
I knew it! I foresaw it 1 minute too late! Alas, alas! How unfortunate is my lot!
Felton did not attempt to resist, and Lord de Winter handed him over to the guards, who, in the meantime, conducted him to a little terrace overlooking the sea. His lordship himself hastened into Buckingham's camp. On hearing the Duke's cry and Patrick's shout, the man whom Felton had met in the antechamber rushed into his grace's room. They found the Duke reclining on a sofa, pressing the wound with his convulsed hand.
The what?
Said the Duke in a dying voice.
The what? Do you come from her?
Yes, your grace, replied the faithful servant with a panic posture.
But I fear I come too late. Hush! The what? You might be overheard. Patrick, let no one enter. Oh, I shall not know what she says to me. My God, I am dying!
The Duke fainted. Nevertheless, Lord de Winter, the deputies, the chiefs of the expedition, and the officers of Buckingham's household had already forced their way into the room. Cries of despair resounded on every side. The tidings which had filled the house with lamentation and groans soon spread and became generally known throughout the town, whilst the report of a cannon announced that something new and unexpected had occurred. Lord de Winter tore his hair.
1 minute too late,
exclaimed he.
1 minute too late! Oh, God, my God, what a misfortune!
He had, in fact, at 7 o'clock in the morning, received information that a rope ladder had been found suspended from one of the windows of the castle, and instantly hastening to her ladyship's chamber, he had found it empty, the window open, and the bars filed through. Remembering then the verbal warning which D'Artagnan had sent to him by his messenger, he had trembled for the Duke, and without a moment's delay, he had mounted the first horse available and galloped at full speed to Portsmouth, dismounted in the courtyard and hastily ascended the staircase, where, as we have already said, he encountered Felton on the topmost step. But the Duke was not yet there. He recovered his senses, again unclosed his eyes, and hope revived in all their hearts.
Gentlemen, said he, leave me alone with Patrick and Lamour. Ah, it is you and De Winter. You sent me a strange madman this morning. See what he has done to me.
Oh, my lord, exclaimed the baron.
Oh, my lord, never shall I forgive myself for it. And there you would belong, De Winter,
said Buckingham, giving him his hand.
I know not any man who is worthy to be invited by another throughout the whole of his life. But leave us, I beseech you.
And the baron left the room, sobbing. There remained in the cabinet only the wounded youth, Lamour, and Patrick. A surgeon had been summoned, but could not be found.
You will live, my lord, you will live,
repeated the messenger of Anne of Austria, kneeling before the Duke.
What has she written to me?
Said Buckingham feebly, as the blood gushed from him, and he subdued in order to speak of her he loved his enormous pains.
What has she written to me? Read me her letter.
Oh, my lord, exclaimed Lamour.
Well, Lamour, do you not see that I have no time to lose?
Lamour instantly broke the seal and held the parchment before the Duke's eyes, but Buckingham in vain attempted to decipher the writing.
Read it, then,
said he.
Read it quickly, for I can no longer see. Read it, for I shall soon be no longer able to hear. We shall die without knowing what she has written to me.
Lamour no longer hesitated. The letter was as follows.
My lord, By all that I have suffered through you and for you, since I have known you, I conjure you, if you have any regard to my repose, to put an end to those vast preparations which you are making against France, and to relinquish a war of which he is openly saying, religion to be avowed, and your love of me the secret cause. That war may not only bring great calamities on France and England, but even upon yourself, my lord. These fortunes for which I could never be consoled. Be careful of your own life, which is threatened, and which will be dear to me from the moment when I shall no longer be obliged to consider you an enemy. Yours affectionately, Anne.
Buckingham roused all his fast failing energies to listen to this letter, and when it was ended as if he experienced a bitter disappointment.
Have you nothing more to tell me? No verbal message, Lapon?
Demanded he.
Yes, my lord. The Queen charged me to bid you to be upon your guard, for she had been warned that you were to be assassinated. Is that all? Is that all?
Resumed Buckingham impatiently.
She charged me also to tell you that she always loved you. God be praised! My death may not be to her as the death of a stranger. Patrick,
continued the Duke,
bring me the casket which contains the diamond studs.
Patrick thought the object he demanded, which Lafosse recognized as having belonged to the Queen.
Now, the white satin bag on which her initials are embroidered in pearls.
Patrick again,
here, Lafosse, said Patrick. Here are the only tokens which I have received from her. This silver casket and these two letters. You will restore them to Her Majesty. And the last souvenir.
He looked around at his unprecious object.
You will have the diamond.
He still strove to find some gift, but his eyes, dimmed by death, encountered nothing but the knife which had fallen from Elton's hand, with the crimson blood still bleeding on its feet.
And you will have to them this knife,
said he, pressing Laporte's hand. He was delayed and placed the satin bag in a casket and dropped the knife upon, as he made a sign to Laporte that he could no longer speak. Then, in a last convulsion, against which he was no longer able to contain, he glided from the silver to the floor. Patrick uttered a loud cry. Buckingham endeavoured to smile once more, but death arrested the thought, which remained engraven on his forehead and lips, like a last farewell of the last speech. At this moment, the Duke's surgeon arrived, completely bewildered. He had already been on board the Admiral's ship when she had been so hastily summoned. He approached the Duke, took his hand, held it for a moment in his own, and then let it fall.
It is all in vain, said he. He is dead.
Dead! Dead!
Echoed Patrick. At this cry, the whole crowd re-entered the apartment, and there was nothing to be seen but consternation and confusion. As soon as Lord de Winter knew that Buckingham had expired, he ran to Felton, whom the soldier still guarded on the terrace.
Wretch,
said he to the young man, who since Buckingham's death had recovered that tranquility and coolness which were never more to abandon him.
Wretch, what have you done?
I have avenged myself, he replied.
Yourself, cried the baron. Say rather that you have been the instrument of that cursed woman. I swear to you that it shall be her last crime.
I do not know what you mean, replied Felton calmly. I am quite ignorant of what woman you are speaking, my lord. I have killed the Duke of Buckingham because he twice refused to make me a captain at your request. I have punished him for his injustice, for no other reason. De Winter looked in his astonishment at the men who were binding Felton, and knew not what to think of such insensibility. One single idea, however, still left a cloud upon Felton's brow. At every step that he heard, the simple Puritan thought he recognized the step and voice of her ladyship, who had come to throw herself into his arms, to accuse herself and to perish with him. Suddenly he scuttled. His glance was fixed upon a point on the sea, which the terrace where he stood completely overlooked. With the eagle eye of a sailor, he had discovered there the sail of a sloop which was bearing on towards the shores of France. He grew pale, pressed his hand upon his heart, which was bursting, but at once comprehended the whole extent of the treachery. Grant me one last favour, said he to the baron.
What is it?
Demanded the latter. What time is it? The baron drew out his watch.
It wants 9:10,
said he. Her ladyship then had anticipated the time of her departure by an hour and a half. As soon as she heard the cannon which announced the fatal event, she had ordered the anchor to be weighed. The boat was now visible under a blue sky at a great distance from the shore.
It was God's will, said Felton,
with the resignation of a fatalist. But still unable to tear his eyes from that bark, on board of which he doubtless believed that he could distinguish the fair vision of her for whom he was about to sacrifice his life. De Winter followed his glances, scrutinized his emotions, and comprehended all that had occurred.
He punished a lone wretch in the first place, said his lordship to Felton,
who allowed himself to be dragged away with his eyes still turned towards the sea.
But I swear to you, by the memory of my brother whom I so truly loved, that your accomplice is not saved.
Felton held down his head without uttering a word. As for De Winter, he hastily descended the stairs and betook himself to the harbour. Chapter 6. In France. The first apprehension of the King of England, Charles I, on hearing of the Duke of Buckingham's death, was lest intelligence so terrible might discourage the Rochellois. Hence he endeavoured, says Richelieu in his memoirs, to conceal it from them as long as possible, closing all the ports of his kingdom, and being scrupulously careful that no vessel should leave until after the departure of the army which Buckingham had been preparing, and whose embarkation he now undertook to superintend in person. He even enforced this order with so much strictness as to detain in England the Danish ambassador, who had already taken leave, and the ambassador from Holland, who was paid back into Flushing, those Dutch Indiamen whose restitution Charles had been given. But, as the King had not thought of issuing this order until 5 hours after the event, two ships had already left the port. One bearing, as we know, her ladyship, who already suspected what had happened, was confirmed in her belief by seeing the black flag unfolding itself from the mast of the Admiral's ship. As for the second vessel, we shall hereafter be told whom to carry and how it got away. During this interval, nothing extraordinary had occurred at the camp before La Rochelle, except that the king, who was as usual bored, and perhaps more so at the camp than elsewhere, resolved to go incognito to enjoy the pace of Saint-Louis at Saint-Germain, and requested the cardinal to provide for him an escort of 20 musketeers. The cardinal, who sometimes was wearied by the gloominess of the king, willingly gave us leave of absence to his royal lieutenant, who promised to return by the 12th of September. When Monsieur de Treville was informed of this journey by his eminence, he prepared his plan. And as, without knowing the cause, he was fully aware of the earnest desire, or rather the imperious necessity that the four friends had for visiting Paris, he marked them out as part of the escort. The four young men received the intelligence a quarter of an hour after Monsieur de Treville, as they were the very first persons to whom he communicated. And then it was that D'Artagnan fully appreciated the favour which the cardinal had conferred upon him in promoting him to the musketeers, since but for that circumstance, he would have been compelled to remain at the camp whilst his companions departed. It will be seen hereafter that his anxiety to return to Paris was occasioned by the danger which Madame Bonacieux was likely to incur from encountering her mortal enemy, Lady de Winter, at the convent of Bethune. Thus, as we have said, Aramis had written immediately to Marie Michon, that seamstress of Tours, who had such exalted acquaintances, that she might solicit from the Queen an order empowering Madame Bonacieux to leave the convent and to take refuge either in Lorraine or Belgium. The answer was not long delayed, for in 8 or 10 days Aramis had received this letter.
My dear cousin, I send the order empowering our little servant to withdraw from the convent of Bethune, but you think that the heir does not agree with her. My sister sends you this order with great pleasure, for she is much attached to this little girl, whom she hopes to benefit in the end. I embrace you, Marie Michon.
To this letter was appended an order in these terms.
The superior of the convent of Bethune will deliver into the hands of the bearer of this note the novice who entered her convent under my recommendation and patronage, and at the Louvre, August 10th, 1628.
It may well be imagined how much this relationship between Aramis and a seamstress at Tours, who called the queen her sister, enlivened the young man. But Aramis, after having 2 or 3 times blushed up to the whites of his eyes at the coarse jokes of Porthos, had begged his friends not to revert to the subject, declaring that if another word were said about it, he would not again employ his cousin as an agent in affairs of the kind. So nothing more about Marie Michon was said between the four musketeers, who had, moreover, obtained what they wanted, the order to withdraw Madame Bonacieux from the convent of Bethune. It is true that this order would be of no great advantage to them whilst they continued in the camp at La Rochelle, that is to say, at the other extremity of France. D'Artagnan was about to ask leave of absence from Monsieur de Treville, plainly confiding to him how important it was that he should depart, when the intelligence reached him, as well as his three companions, that the king was about to proceed to Paris with an escort of 20 musketeers, of which they were to form a part. Great was their joy. Their servants were sent forward with the baggage, and they themselves set out in the morning of the 16th. The cardinal attended the king from Sougère to Mons, where the king and his minister took leave of each other with great professions of friendship. Nevertheless, the king, although he travelled very fast, if he wished to reach Paris by the 23rd, was so anxious for amusement that he halted from time to time to hunt for the magpie, a pastime for which he had acquired a taste from the Louvre, the first husband of Madame de Chevreuse, and for which he had always preserved a great liking. 16 of the 20 musketeers much enjoyed this sport, but 4 of them cursed it most heartily. D'Artagnan, more especially, had a perpetual humming in his ears, which Porthos thus explained.
A woman of the highest rank assured me that this is a sign that someone is talking about you somewhere.
On the night of the 23rd, the escort at length passed through Paris. The king thanked Monsieur de Treville and allowed him to grant 4 days' leave of absence to his men, on condition that not one of the favoured individuals should appear at any public place and obtain his last leave. The first 4 leaves were granted, as may be imagined, to our 4 friends. And, more than that, Athos persuaded Monsieur de Treville to extend it to 6 days instead of 4, and managed to cram 2 more nights into these 6 days. For they set off on the 24th at 5 o'clock in the evening, and Monsieur de Treville had the complaisance to post-date the leave to the morning of the 25th.
Oh, mon dieu, said D'Artagnan,
who, as we are well aware, never foresaw a difficulty. It appears to me that we are making a great disturbance about a very simple matter. In 2 days, by foundering 2 or 3 horses, which I should not care about, since I have plenty of money, I could be at Bethune. I should then deliver the Queen's letter to the abbess, who could bring back the dear treasure which I am seeking, not to Lorraine, not to Belgium, but to Paris, where she might be much more securely concealed, particularly whilst the cardinal remains at La Rochelle. Then, when the campaign is once ended, partly from the protection of her cousin, and partly from what we have ourselves personally done for her, we shall obtain from the Queen whatever we desire. Remain, therefore, here. Do not fatigue yourselves uselessly. My budget shall be quite sufficient for so simple an expedition. To this, Athos quietly replied, and we also have got some money. But I have not yet quite drunk the remains of the diamond, and Porthos and Aramis have not quite eaten them up, so we may as well founder 4 horses in 1. But remember, D'Artagnan, he added, in a voice so sad that his accent made the young man shudder, remember that Bethune is a town where the cardinal has made an appointment with a woman who, wherever she goes, brings misfortune with her. If you had only 4 men to deal with, D'Artagnan, I should let you go alone. But you have to deal with this woman. So let all 4 of us go, and God grant that with our 4 valets we may be in sufficient number.
You quite terrify me, Athos, exclaimed D'Artagnan. What, then, do you dread?
Everything, replied Athos. D'Artagnan looked into the countenances of his companions, which, like that of Athos, bore the impress of profound anxiety, and they continued their journey at the utmost speed of their horses, but without uttering another word. On the evening of the 26th, as they were entering Arras, and just as D'Artagnan had dismounted at the tavern of the Golden Harrow to drink a glass of wine, a cavalier came out of the yard of the change house, where he had just changed his horse, and proceeded at full gallop on the road to Paris. At the moment that he issued from the great gate into the street, the wind opened the cloak in which he was wrapped, although it was the month of August, and lifted up his hat, which he caught and pushed violently down upon his forehead. D'Artagnan, whose looks were fixed upon this man, turned very pale, and let fall his glance.
She's the lady, sir.
Cried Roger.
Oh, dear, dear, that nice gentleman, my master is ill.
The three friends hastened in and found out Hangnot, who, instead of being ill, was running to his horse. They stopped him on the threshold at the door.
Oh, Lord, where the plague are you going in this manner?
Cried Hangnot.
That is he,
exclaimed D'Artagnan, pale with passion and with a perspiration in beads on his brow.
It is he, let me get at him. But who do you mean?
Demanded Athos.
He, that man.
What man?
That cursed man, my evil genius, whom I had always seen when I was threatened with some misfortune. He who accompanied that horrible woman when I met her the first time. He whom I was seeking when I affronted our friend Athos. He whom I saw the very morning of the day when the unborn seer was abducted. The man of moon, in fact. I saw him. It is he. I recognized him when the wind opened his cloak.
The devil, said Athos.
To horse, gentlemen, to horse. Let us pursue him. We must catch him.
My dear fellow, said Aramis, consider that he is going exactly the opposite road to ours, but that he has a fresh horse, whilst our horses are down, and that consequently we should knock up our horses without even a chance of overtaking him.
Hello, sir,
cried out the stable boy, running after the stranger.
Hello, sir, here is a paper which fell out of your hat. Hello, sir, hello.
My friend, said D'Artagnan, Artemis Foley for that paper.
Hey, sir, with the greatest pleasure, here it is.
The stable boy, delighted with the good day's work he had made of it, returned into the yard of the hotel, and D'Artagnan unfolded the paper.
Well,
inquired his friends, listening. Only one word, said D'Artagnan.
Yes,
said Aramis, but that word is the name of a town.
Armentieres,
read Porthos.
Armentieres? I do not know the place.
And this name of a town is written in her hand, said Athos.
Come, come, let us take great care of this paper,
said D'Artagnan. Perhaps I shall not have thrown away my half pistole.
To horse, my friends, to horse!
The four companions went off at a gallop on the road to Bethune. Chapter 61. The Carmelite Convent of Bethune. Great criminals are endowed with a kind of predestination which enables them to surmount every obstacle and to escape every danger until the moment on which a weary providence has fixed for the shipwreck of their unhallowed fortune. But thus it was with her ladyship. She passed between the cruisers of two nations and landed at Boulogne without mishap. When she disembarked at Portsmouth, her ladyship had been an Englishwoman driven from La Rochelle by the persecutions of France. When she came on shore at Boulogne, after a voyage of 2 days, she represented herself as a Frenchwoman, whom the English annoyed at Portsmouth on account of the hatred which they entertained for France. Her ladyship had, moreover, the best of passports, aided by the liberality with which she scattered her bestowals. Free from the customary formalities, by the affable smile and gallant manners of an old governor of the port, who kissed her hand, she only remained at Boulogne a sufficient time to put into the post a letter written in these terms.
To His Eminence, the Lord Cardinal Richelieu, at his camp before La Rochelle.
My Lord, Your Eminence may be assured that His Grace, the Duke of Buckingham, will not set out for France. Lady de Boulogne, August 25th, evening. Yet, according to Your Eminence's desire, I am proceeding to the Carmelite Convent of Bethune, where I shall await your orders. In fact, her ladyship began her journey on the same night. Darkness overtook her when she stopped and slept in a tavern on the road. At 5 o'clock the next morning, she resumed her journey within 3 hours, reaching her funeral. She inquired her way to the convent of the Carmelites and immediately entered it. The abbess came to meet her, and when her ladyship showed the cardinal's order, a chamber was immediately prepared for her and breakfast served. The scenes of the past had all faded from this woman's sight, and with her eyes fixed upon the future, she only saw the high fortune which was reserved for her by that cardinal whom she had so well served, without his name being at all compromised by the blind deed. The ever-changing passions which consumed her gave to her light the appearance of a cloud which ascended to the sky, reflecting sometimes the azure tint, sometimes the lurid, and sometimes the blackness of the storm, yet leaving no traces but those of devastation. After breakfast, the abbess came to pay her visit. There are but few amusements in the cloister, and the good superior was in haste to strike up acquaintance with her new ward. Her ladyship wished to please the abbess, and this was a very easy task for a woman so truly superior. She endeavoured to be amiable, and became charming, so that her entertainer was seduced by her varied conversation, as well as by the grades which appeared in all her person. The abbess, who was of a noble family, loved more especially that gossip of the court which so rarely reaches the extremities of the kingdom, and which has especially so much difficulty in passing through the walls of a convent on whose threshold all worldly sounds should cease. Her ladyship, however, was well versed in all the intrigues of the aristocracy, in whose midst she had constantly lived for 5 or 6 years. She therefore set about amusing the good abbess with an account of all the worldly practices of the French court, mixed up with the excessive devotions of the king. She gave her also the chronicle of scandals concerning those lords and ladies of the court, by whose names the abbess was familiar, and touched lightly on the amours of the queen and Buckingham, talking herself a great deal, that she might thus induce the abbess to talk a little. But the abbess contented herself with listening and smiling, without replying. Nevertheless, as her ladyship perceived that these sorts of stories amused her greatly, she continued them, only to divert the conversation to the cardinal. On this point, however, she was slightly embarrassed, as she knew not whether the abbess was royalist or cardinalist. She therefore kept prudently to a middle path. The abbess, on her part, maintained a still more prudent reserve, contenting herself with making a profound inclination of the head as often as the traveller mentioned the cardinal's name. Her ladyship soon began to think that she should find this convent very tiresome. She resolved, therefore, to hazard something in order to know what course to steer. Wishing to ascertain how far the discretion of the abbess would extend, she began to speak unfavorably, at first by hints, and then most circumstantially, to the cardinal, relating the amours of that minister with Madame d'Aguillon, Marion de Lorne, and some other women of gallantry. The abbess listened more attentively, gradually became more animated, and smiled. Thought her ladyship, she begins to relish my conversation. If she is a cardinalist, she is, at any rate, no very fanatical one. She then dwelt upon the persecution which the cardinal conducted against his enemies. The abbess merely crossed herself without approving or blaming.
This confirmed her ladyship in the belief that the good superior was more of a royalist than a cardinalist. So she continued her remarks, becoming more and more severe.
I am very ignorant of all such matters, said the Countess at last. But remote as we are from the court, secluded and refined ourselves from intercourse with the world, we have most melancholy proofs of the truth of what you have been just relating. And one of our warders has suffered severely from the vengeance and persecutions of the cardinal.
One of your warders? Said the ladyship. Oh, poor creature. How I pity her.
And you are right, for she is much to be pitied. Imprisonment, threats, ill treatment, all these she has endured. But after all, continued the Countess, the cardinal had perhaps plausible reactions for acting thus, and although she has the aspect of an angel, we must not always judge the people by their aspect.
Right, said her ladyship to herself. Who knows? I may perhaps make some discovery in him. I'm just in the humour for it. She then set herself to communicate to her countenance an expression of most perfect candour.
Alas, said she, I know that. They tell us that we must not trust physiognomies. What can we trust if not the most beautiful of the Lord's works? As for me, I shall probably be deceived throughout my whole life by always confiding that person whose face inspires me with sympathy.
You would be induced, then, to believe that this young woman was innocent,
said the Abbot. The cardinal does not merely punish crimes, replied her ladyship. There are certain virtues which he visits more severely than sin.
You will allow me, madam, to express my surprise,
said the Abbot.
But what?
Asked her ladyship, with apparent simplicity.
But the language which you use.
And what do you find astonishing in that language? Demanded her ladyship, with a smile.
You are the cardinal's friend, since he has sent you here, and yet...
And yet I speak ill of him, replied her ladyship, expressing the Abbot's thought.
At least you do not speak much good of him.
It is because I am not his friend, but his victim, said her ladyship, sighing.
And yet that letter by which he has recommended you to me
is an order to me to keep myself in a sort of prison from which he will remove me through some of his satellites.
But why did you not escape?
Where should I go? Do you believe that there is a spot upon the earth which the cardinal cannot reach if he pleases to take the trouble to stretch out his hand? If I were a man, it might perchance be possible, but being a woman, what would you have a woman do? This young boarder of yours, has she attempted to escape?
No, truly, but her case is different. I fancy that she is kept in France by some love affair.
Then, said her ladyship with a sigh, loving, she is not altogether unhappy.
So, said the Abbot, looking with increasing interest at her ladyship, it is another poor persecuted creature that I see.
Alas, yes, said her ladyship.
The Abbot looked at her ladyship for an instant with some inquietude, as if a new thought were just arising in her mind. You are not an enemy of our most holy faith,
said she, stammering.
I, cried her ladyship, I a Protestant? Oh, no, I call the God who now hears us to witness that I am indeed a zealous Catholic.
Then, madam, replied the Abbot, smiling, be of good cheer. The house in which you are shall not be a very severe prison for you, and we will do all we can to soften your captivity. Moreover, you shall see that young woman who is no doubt persecuted on account of some court intrigue. She is so amiable and so gracious that she is sure to please you.
What is her name?
She has been recommended to us under the name of Kitty by a person of the highest rank. I have not endeavoured to find out her second name.
Kitty? Explained her ladyship. Are you quite sure?
Yes, madam. At least so she calls herself. Do you suppose you know her?
Her ladyship smiled as the idea suggested itself to her that this female might possibly be her former attendant. With her recollection of a younger woman, there was associated a sentiment of anger and a desire for revenge, which somewhat disturbed the serenity of her ladyship's features. But they soon resumed that expression of calmness and benevolence which this woman with a hundred faces had for the time adopted.
But when may I see this young lady, for whom I already feel so great a sympathy?
Demanded her ladyship.
This evening, replied the Abbot. Nay, even today. But as you say, you have been travelling for 4 days and arose this morning at 5 o'clock. You must now be in want of rest. Lie down, therefore, and sleep. But we will awaken you at dinner time.
Although her ladyship could have very well dispensed with sleep, supported as she was by the excitement which a new adventure kindled in her heart, so eager after intrigues, she nevertheless accepted the offer of the Abbot. During the previous 12 or 14 days, she had experienced so many different emotions that though her iron constitution was still able to endure fatigue, her mind required some repose. She therefore took leave of the Abbot and lay down in peace, comforted by the ideas of vengeance to which the name of Kitty had so naturally led her. She remembered the almost unlimited promise which the cardinal had made to her on condition of the success of her enterprise. She had succeeded, and she might, therefore, avenge herself on D'Artagnan. One thing alone alarmed her ladyship, and that was the recollection of her husband, the Count de la Fère, whom she had believed to be dead, or at least expatriated, and whom she now found in Athos, the dearest friend of D'Artagnan. But if he was D'Artagnan's friend, he must have assisted him in all those plots by the aid of which the Queen had thwarted the designs of his enemies. If he was D'Artagnan's friend, he must be the Cardinal's enemy, and she should undoubtedly be able to envelop him in that vengeance, in the folds of which she hoped to stifle the young musketeer. All these hopes formed agreeable thoughts to her ladyship, and, lulled by them, she soon slept. She was awakened by a soft voice which sounded at the foot of her bed. On opening her eyes, she saw the Abbot, accompanied by a young woman with fair hair and a delicate complexion, who fixed on her a look full of kindly curiosity. The countenance of this young woman was entirely unknown to her. As they exchanged the usual curses, they examined each other with scrupulous attention. Both were very beautiful, yet quite unlike each other in their kindness and beauty, and her ladyship smiled on observing that she had herself much more of a high-bred air and aristocratic manner. It is true that the dress of a novice which the young woman wore was not very favourable to success in a competition of the sort. The abbess presented them to one another, and then, as her own duties demanded her attendance in the chapel, she left them alone together. The novice, seeing her ladyship in bed, would have followed the abbess, but her ladyship detained her.
"Why, madam," said she, "I have scarcely seen you. Did you already wish to deprive me of your company, which I had hoped to enjoy during the time that I may remain here?"
"No, madam," replied the novice,
"but as you are fatigued, I fear that my visit has been badly timed."
"Well," said her ladyship, "what should those who sleep desire?
A pleasant awakening. That is just what you have given me, so let me enjoy it at my ease."
And taking her hand, he drew her to a chair near the bed.
"Mon Dieu," said the novice, seating herself, "how unfortunate I am. Here have I been in this house for 6 months, without even the shadow of amusement. You and I, your presence would provide me with most charming company. But now, according to all probability, I shall immediately leave the convent."
"What?" said her ladyship. "Are you going away soon?"
"At least I hope so," replied the novice,
with an expression of joy which she did not in the least attempt to disguise.
"I think I heard that you had suffered from the persecutions of the cardinal," said her ladyship. "It is another bond of sympathy between us." "What our good mother has told me is true, then. But you are also one of the cardinal's victims."
"Hush," said her ladyship. "Even here do not let us speak of him.
All my misfortunes have arisen from having spoken scarcely more than you have just said, before a woman whom I thought my friend, and who betrayed me. Are you also the victim of treachery?"
"No," said the novice,
"but of my devotion to a woman whom I love, for whom I would have died, and for whom I would die now."
"And who deserted you in your distress?"
"I know she did. I was unjust enough to believe so. And within the last 2 or 3 days, I have had proof of the contrary, and I thank God for it. I should have deeply grieved at the conviction that she had forgotten me. But you, madam, you seem to be free and able to escape if you should have any inclination to do so. And where could I go? Without friends, without money, in a part of France which I do not know.
Where?"
"Oh, as to friends," said the novice, "you will find them wherever you please. You look so good, and you are so beautiful."
"That is no reason," said her ladyship, softening her smile so as to give to it an angelical expression,
"why I should not be forsaken and persecuted." "Listen," said the novice, "you must trust in heaven. There always comes a moment when the good that we have done pleads for us before God's throne. Besides, it is perhaps a piece of good fortune for you that, humble and powerless as I am, you should have met me here. For if I should get away, I have some influential friends who, having exerted themselves for me, may do the same for you."
"No, when I say that I was solitary and forsaken," said her ladyship, hoping to make the novice speak more plainly by speaking herself,
"it is not that I have not some lofty acquaintances also, but these acquaintances all tremble before the cardinal. The Queen herself does not defend me against this terrible minister, but I have proofs that Her Majesty, in spite of her excellent heart, has been more than once obliged to abandon, to His Eminence's rage, persons who have faithfully served her. Believe me, madam, it may have appeared that the Queen forsook her friends, but you must not believe the appearance. The more they are persecuted, the more she thinks of them, and often at the very moment when they suppose her the least mindful of them, they receive an evidence of her kind remembrance."
"Alas," said her ladyship,
"I believe it. The Queen is so good."
"Oh, you know her then, this beautiful and noble Queen, since you speak of her thus?" exclaimed the novice enthusiastically.
"That is to say," replied her ladyship, rather forced back into her entrenchments, "I do not have the honour of knowing her personally, but I do know many of her most intimate friends. I know Monsieur de Coutange. I knew Monsieur Dujac in England, and I know Monsieur de Treville."
"Monsieur de Treville?" exclaimed the novice.
"Do you know Monsieur de Treville?"
"Yes, intimately.
The captain of the King's Musketeers?"
"Yes, the captain of the King's Musketeers."
"Oh, then you will see presently that we must be acquaintances, almost friends. If you know Monsieur de Treville, you must be at his house."
"Often," said her ladyship, who, having entered on this path, and finding falsehood profitable, determined to pursue it to the end.
"At his house, he must have seen some of his musketeers,
all of them whom he is in the habit of receiving," replied her ladyship, who began to take a real interest in the conversation.
"Name some of those that you know," said the novice, "and you will see that they are amongst my friends."
"Who?" said her ladyship, somewhat confused.
"I know Monsieur de Louigny, Monsieur de Corrivant, and Monsieur de Farouza."
The novice let her go on, but seeing her pause, said,
"Do you not know a gentleman named Farouza?"
Her ladyship became as pale as the sheets on which she was reclining, and mistress as she was of her emotions, she could not help uttering a cry as she seized the hand of the novice and fastened her gaze upon her.
"Ah, what is the matter with you? Oh, mon Dieu,"
said the poor young woman.
"Have I said anything to offend you?"
"No, but I was struck by the name, for I have been acquainted with this gentleman also,
and it seems strange that I should meet with anyone who knew him well."
"Oh yes, very well, and his friends also, Monsieur Porthos and Monsieur Aramis."
"Really? And I know them too,"
exclaimed her ladyship, who felt a cold shudder penetrate into her heart. "Well, if you are acquainted with them, you ought to know that they are good and brave companions. Why do you not apply to them if you want protection?"
"That is to say," stammered her ladyship, "I am not very intimate with any one of them. I know them from having heard them spoken of by one of their friends, Monsieur D'Artagnan."
"You know Monsieur D'Artagnan?" exclaimed the novice, in turn, seizing her ladyship's hand and devouring her with her looks. And then remarking the strange expression of her ladyship's countenance,
"Pardon me, madame, you know him, but in what character?"
"Why," replied her ladyship, in some embarrassment,
"in the character of a friend."
"You deceive me, madam," said the novice.
"You have been his mistress."
"It is you who have been that," said her ladyship in turn.
I,
said the novice.
"Yes, you. I know you now.
You are Madame Bonacieux." The young woman drew herself back, overwhelmed with astonishment and terror.
"Oh, do not deny it, but pray answer,"
said her ladyship.
"Well, yes, madam, I love him,"
said the novice.
"Are we rivals?"
Her ladyship's face was irradiated by a light so wild that, under any other circumstances, Madame Bonacieux would have fled from her in terror. But she was not entirely absorbed by jealousy.
"Come, tell me, madame,"
said Madame Bonacieux,
with an energy of which she would have been thought incapable.
Have you been his mistress?
Oh, no, exclaimed her ladyship in a tone which prohibited any doubt of her honesty.
Never, never.
I believe you, said Madame Bonacieux.
But why did you cry out so?
What, do you not understand? Said her ladyship, who had already recovered from her confusion and had resumed all her presence of mind.
How should I understand? I know nothing.
Do you not understand that Monsieur D'Artagnan, being my friend, made me his confidant?
Really?
Do you not understand that I am acquainted with everything that has taken place? Your abduction from the little house of Saint-Germain, his despair, that of his friends, and their researches ever since that time. Is it strange for me to be astonished on finding myself, without being aware of it, by the side of you, of whom we have so often talked together, of you whom he loves with all the strength of his soul, of you whom he made me love before I beheld you? Ah, dear Constance, I find you at last. At last I see you.
Her ladyship held out her arms towards Madame Bonacieux, who, convinced by what she had just heard, now saw in this woman, whom she had an instant before regarded as a rival, only a sincere and a devoted friend.
Pardon me, pardon me,
said she, allowing herself to sink upon her ladyship's shoulder.
I love him so much.
These two women held each other for an instant thus embraced. Certainly, if her ladyship's strength had been but equal to her hatred, Madame Bonacieux would not have left her arms alive. But not being able to stifle her, she smiled.
Oh, dear little pretty thing, said her ladyship. How delighted I am to see you. Let me look at you.
And as she uttered these words, she did, in fact, devour her with her looks.
Yes, it is certainly yours. Ah, after what he told me of you, I recognize you now. I recognize you perfectly well.
The poor young woman did not suspect the horrid cruelty that was raging behind the rampart of that unruffled brow, or behind those eyes in which she only read the interest of compassion.
Then you know what I have suffered, said Madame Bonacieux, since he has told you what he himself endured, but to suffer for him is a joy.
Her ladyship replied mechanically,
yes, it is a joy.
But she was thinking of something else.
And then, continued Madame Bonacieux, my punishment draws near its end. Tomorrow, this very evening perhaps, I shall see him once more, and then the past will be forgotten.
This evening? Tomorrow?
Exclaimed her ladyship, aroused from her reverie by these words.
What can you mean? Do you expect to hear anything of him?
I expect him. Himself.
Himself? D'Artagnan, here?
Yes, himself.
But it is impossible. He is at the siege of La Rochelle with the cardinal. He will not return to Paris until after the town is taken.
You think so?
But is there anything impossible to my D'Artagnan, the noble and loyal gentleman? Oh, I cannot believe you.
Well then, read,
said this unfortunate young woman, in the excess of her pride and joy, showing a letter to her ladyship.
The writing of Madame de Chevreuse, said her ladyship to herself. Ah, I was quite sure that there were some communications in that quarter.
And she eagerly read these lines.
My dear child, be ready. Our friend will soon see you, and he will only come to snatch you from the prison where it was necessary for your own safety to conceal you. So prepare for your departure and never despair of us. Our brave Gaston has just shown himself as brave and as faithful as ever. Tell him that there is much gratitude to him in a certain quarter for the warning which he gave.
Yes, yes, said her ladyship.
The letter is very precise. And do you know what this warning was?
No, I only suspect that he must have warned the Queen of some new machination of the cardinal.
Yes, that is it, beyond a doubt, said her ladyship, returning the letter and letting her head fall pensively on her breast.
At that moment, the gallop of a horse was heard.
Oh,
exclaimed Madame Bonacieux, rushing to the window.
Can this be he?
Her ladyship remained in her bed, petrified by the surprise. So many unexpected things had suddenly happened to her that, for the first time, her head failed me.
He,
muttered she, and if it should be? And she continued in bed, with her eyes fixed on vacancy.
Alas, no,
said Madame Bonacieux. It is a man whom I do not know.
But he seems to be coming.
Yes, he is riding more slowly.
He stops at the gate.
He rings.
Her ladyship sprang out of bed.
You are quite sure that it is not he?
Oh, yes, certainly.
Perhaps you do not see him distinctly.
Oh, should I see only the plume in his hat, or the skirt of his cloak, I should not fail to recognize him.
Her ladyship was dressing all the time.
No matter. The man is coming here, you say?
Yes, he is coming.
It must be either for you or for me.
Oh, mon dieu. How agitated you are.
Yes, I confess that I have not your confidence. I read everything from the cardinal.
Hush,
said Madame Bonacieux.
Someone is coming.
The door opened, and the abbess entered.
Did you come from Boulogne? Demanded she of her ladyship.
Yes, madam,
replied the latter, endeavouring to resume her composure.
Who wants me?
A man who will not give his name, but who comes from the cardinal.
And who wants to speak to me?
Demanded her ladyship.
Who wants to speak with a lady who has just arrived from Boulogne?
Then show him in, madam, I beg of you.
Oh, my God,
said Madame Bonacieux.
Can it be any bad news?
I fear so.
I leave you with this stranger, but as soon as he shall have gone, I will return if you will allow me.
Yes, I beseech you to do so.
The abbess and Madame Bonacieux left the room. Her ladyship remained alone, with her eyes fixed upon the door. A moment afterwards, the jingling sound of spurs were heard on the stairs. Then the steps came nearer. Then the door was opened, and a man appeared. Her ladyship uttered a cry of joy. This man was the Count de Rochefort, the familiar of his eminence. Chapter 62. Two kinds of demons.
Ah! Exclaimed both Rochefort and her ladyship at the same instant.
It is you.
Yes, it is I.
And you come from?
Demanded her ladyship.
From La Rochelle. And you?
From England.
And Buckingham?
He's dead or dangerously wounded. As I was leaving without having obtained anything from him, a fanatic had just assassinated him.